Welcome to another edition of Six Pack Cinema. This week we saw The Post, and we're still trying to figure out why it's getting all this awards love. All right, let's go.
Dude, you should review movies.
Oh my god, yes.
Okay, I've had a couple, so.
Movie review.
Hey, we are live. How are you guys doing? You guys have a good weekend?
Super.
I haven't left this chair going on like 18 hours besides sleep, so good. Getting a lot of work done.
That sounds both great and horrible.
Have you opened that window, NL? Get some light in?
I think that's a good way to put it. I showered before this podcast because I just needed like a halftime break. It just felt really gross. And I was in the same clothes and I was like, just a refresher. So I took a nice little cold shower, went to the store, got some batteries. Now I'm back. Got some Lifesaver gummies.
Nice.
But yeah, crazy busy weekend.
So you're living your best life.
I love it because I'm doing all Talking Yank stuff and a lot of podcast editing. So I love it.
So let's hop into our snap impressions then. Jimmy, what did you think of The Post?
Meh. Just super bleh.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Just really boring. Really boring. Not boring.
No, I wouldn't say
boring. Like, not boring, but not interesting. Maybe the story is interesting, but they didn't. I think it was a lot of good, really good actors doing really mundane performances. And in the end, it was just kind of like, they're going to show this in high school journalism classes. And they're going to think it's like a PSA for journalism and not an actual good movie.
Okay. I kind of agree with that. So we're going to go in order from, I think, our highest opinion to our lowest. So Sheehan, I'm saving you for last. I think you have the lowest.
No.
Just off your tweet. I thought that.
Okay.
But no, I agree with that. It was very okay. It was a very okay movie for me. I think if the same movie had been put out by a different ensemble, I would have probably liked it a lot more. But because everyone in this is so good, it didn't live up to the expectations I had. Like, when you get Spielberg, Hanks, everyone who's in this, I just expect a 10 out of 10 movie, and that's not what this was. So I was let down by that, I think.
I think everyone was. Remember a few months ago, I told you this one was a favorite for the best picture before it was even finished filming. That's the expectations you had, you know? I think this was a victim of trying to do too much. Spielberg tried to do too much. I think he might have been bullied by Meryl Streep to do too much. This movie didn't know if it was going to be a woman's empowerment movie or a right to free press movie. So they kind of did half-ass in each one.
Yeah. I mean, I agree. That shot of her walking out and all those women just staring up at her, like, lovingly.
And one, the Black Power sign, which was completely out of place.
Yeah.
That shot was what I'm talking about. Like, PSA, corny ass, feel good, not gripping. That scene, that shot was terrible.
I feel like they threw that in at the end, like, as a fluff. Like, look, women are having a hard time in Hollywood now. Let's make this a woman empowerment movie. That felt like a throw-in at the end.
It just felt very generic.
It felt forced.
The thing I hated the most was at the very end when she turns to... So let's just hop into our deep dive of what we didn't like. The thing I hated, I'm just starting off with that, at the very end when she just turns and talks to Hank and goes on and on about how the press is so great and they don't always get it right, but they're going to keep trying time and again, which had nothing to do with anything in the scene at all and felt like a PSA. I was like, this is fucking absurd. And I was like getting angry. I was like, just end already. Like, I want to be out of the theater.
Yeah, it was the right to publish real news, not getting it wrong. They actually had legitimate, real documents in their hands, not a fake, not a, you know, thoughts or
fake news.
It wasn't fake news. For sure, it was not fake news. They had actual, real documents about the shitty things the government was doing, and they published it. That, in no way, shape, or form, was a first draft. That was, we need to get this news out because we're the only people that can do it. We're the only people with a voice big enough to reach this many people to get the news out there and create real change. Why they went into the fact is like, oh, well, the newspaper is a rough draft of history. I get what they're saying. That's a common, like, publishing term, I guess. But stay on focus. That was my issue the whole time. Is like they didn't stay on topic. They try to do too much. too many feel good lines, you know, too many things to call out and say, oh yeah, this movie did this and that for this people and that people. I don't know.
I agree. I feel like it was rushed out through post-production just to be out in time for awards.
Yes.
I think there's probably a very good movie on the cutting room floor of this.
I agree.
I don't, man. I think they just forced everything to be, and it was so corny.
I mean, I love this type of story. I love political dramas and like historically political dramas. I love this shit. So I was really excited.
There was nothing interesting about this. But newspaper gets source, releases source. Well, no, but
they were put on the New York Times and the Washington Post was put on trial. That's a big point of history.
Yeah,
I agree. I think they didn't hammer home that part. Yes. They it was too much surface level stuff, and they didn't actually like go deep into it. Or
I agree. I think they
it was 40 minutes of like, should we do this or should we not do it? I don't care about your decision making. Do it, and then show me the decision making of the court.
Yes, exactly.
That would be much more interesting. What did the judges say behind closed doors? That's the story here.
It is
not whether they decided to publish or not. Who cares? That was so boring.
No, I agree. I was just saying. I felt like they spent too much time on the newspaper's decision, and it should have been kind of half the story was that, and then the other half was the court, the actual courtroom drama. I would have loved to see this as a courtroom drama.
Same. Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Okay. Agreed.
All right. What did you guys actually like about the movie? We should try and add some positives in here.
I got a lot more negatives coming, so I'll do so. We can do some positives. I gotta get on my notes.
All right. We'll do a brief moment of happiness here. Okay. We already know mine. I love the fact that Sheehan was a real character in history. And Jimmy, I'm going to ask you for one favor. If nothing else, I need you to give me a little snippet of Tom Hanks looking at the camera and says, "Find out what Sheehan's doing." I need that in my life.
Fair. All right. Okay. Any relation to you?
Probably. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
All right.
For sure.
Smart answer.
I'm a big details guy, and I love period pieces, especially in the 60s. The cars are they always show the powerful guys in Cadillacs and these big, enormous cars. I love how they showed Tom Hanks rolling down the street in this tiny piece of shit. Datsun, maybe? The thing was, it was like a clown car for him. Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they had, every time they have an actor in a car driving down the street, they always had the light on the visor to highlight their face. Mm-hmm. It was so close to his forehead, it was a hot spot. So, I got a kick out of that. I guess that's a bad thing, but I liked it. So,
I liked all the stuff, all the behind the scenes making of the newspaper,
yes,
the printing press shit. That was cool. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Could have watched that stuff, like how they did it, the intricacies. It seems like such a hassle.
Typing and all the letters falling in place. That was so cool.
Made me, I had like a good chuckle thinking about just the newspaper industry in general and how much work and effort went into this and the internet and Twitter and shit just completely
just destroyed it.
So silly to me. They were acting like, we only have 12 hours to get this to press. We better hurry. It's like, dude, 12 hours is 3 news cycles today.
Yeah.
It's so funny how much that's a dying industry.
It's dead. I know.
Yeah, it's not dying. It is dead.
It is dead. I walked out of thinking, you know what? I miss reading the Boston Globe. I wonder if I can get that. And I was like, there's no chance I can get that.
Yeah.
No.
I love just to compound on that, the very last scene when they're showing like the printing press floor and the swirling of the papers going up to the ceiling. Why? What was that? I'm sure it was necessary for some reason, but it was beautiful, but I don't get why. Like in real life, like why do they have to carry them up that high? Didn't they fall at some point? Like, I don't know.
Were they bringing them to a different station? I have no idea.
Maybe they were just drying them out. I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah, I got a lot of questions. Zero idea.
I was going to say, I actually really liked the very end where it showed the Watergate stuff going on, because I don't know if you guys have seen it or realized it, because that was a shot-for-shot remake from his other movie, All the President's Men. So it kind of created this as a prequel to that, which was about the Watergate scandal. So I thought that was just...
I really didn't like that.
No, you didn't? At first, I thought it was weird until I realized I rewatched All the President's Men and realized it was the same.
Really?
Scene?
But it's such a gimmick.
No, I had a different take on that. I thought I had a different like little clever note. I was like, you know what? This is that was a shot-for-shot remake of Tom Hanks's famous movie Forrest Gump, watching the Watergate break it happen.
No. Well, isn't that footage? Wasn't that real footage?
No.
In Forrest Gump, it is.
Really?
In this movie, it's not. Yes.
When he's looking through his hotel room at the across. The
I think wave. I think they use the real footage in that.
I was just talking about Nixon on the phone.
Oh.
Oh, that yes. was. I think that's actual recording.
Recording, real recording. Yep, Nixon tapes.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah, mm-hmm. I thought that was too much of a gimmick. Like the too much of the audience be like, "Aha, aha, how cute!" It's like,
oh, that's I not liked this it movie. Because now I was treating it as a prequel to All the President's Men.
I've never seen that.
All the President's Men, much better than this movie.
Yeah,
I'm gonna have to check that out.
All right, and I also liked Hanks. I felt like he was the only actor I actually liked in this, but he's one of my people that I feel like can do no wrong, and this was probably one of his lesser roles.
He was that's what I'm saying. Sort of they didn't even like use himself, the best of Tom Hanks.
No.
Can you remember a scene where it was like, there it is, that's Tom Hanks. He's fucking crushed that scene.
Yes.
What scene?
When he was pleading with her to print at her birthday.
Yes. I agree with that.
That was vintage Hanks. And then the little snide, like, by the way, happy birthday. I liked it.
I love Tom Hanks. I don't think he was bad in this. I just think it wasn't what he usually is or can
it
be.
It wasn't his best. No. Absolutely not. But, I mean...
It wasn't his best, but he was the best out of everyone else being mediocre.
Yeah. I think you could have swapped him out for Denzel Washington for the nomination this year, but it was a token one at best that he wasn't going to win. It's not award worthy. It was just good to see Tom Hanks on screen again. That's all.
Fair.
Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, let's go back to things we hate, because everybody hates a lot of things about this movie. Jimmy, you want to run through a couple of things on your list?
Yeah. They opened with scenes of Vietnam, helicopters, and Creedence Clearwater Revival playing. Like, come on. Just come on.
Come on. What? Like, why? What's wrong with that? Other than the fact that it's used in every fucking movie ever, but it's
the biggest cliche cop out easy thing ever. I don't know. I just Spielberg. I expect like good new wave. I don't think he's new wave anymore. I think he's stuck in 10 years ago and hasn't given us anything groundbreaking or like new.
But I need to counter this
because
Creedence is perfect for that scene. In this movie.
If you're a high school student and you make a movie about Vietnam with a helicopter shot, you're going to use Creedence. Every 17-year-old would do that. Everyone does that.
You listen to the lyrics of that song, it goes perfectly with this movie. I'm sorry it's been used by all the idiot 17-year-olds before, but it fit. It's all about the guys getting sent overseas to Vietnam for a stupid ass war, and meanwhile the government's all the politicians' sons, they never have to go because the draft didn't pick them for some reason.
And I agree, it is overused, but it's overused for a reason. It fits perfectly with the era, and it sucks that there's been so many movies about the era that it gets annoying.
Yeah,
but it still fits. I don't think you go with a lesser choice just because you don't want the cliche.
I think you find a better choice or a neutral. I think it's a parody of itself. Like that opened up, and I was like, "Oh Jesus Christ!"
Yeah, I think you eliminate that altogether because it's not about. We already know about Vietnam. If you're watching this movie, you already understand that. So I don't think they needed it. They could have showed some. They could have started it with the airplane ride. He's like, "Hey, you've been there." Like, yeah, I'm impressed by how much it's the same. Mm-hmm. Start the movie there, and it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Do you want to move on to the next complaint?
Sure.
Meryl Streep stunk in the first half of this movie. Until she had her big scene, the movie was moving, screeching halt every time she came on. And then we just watched her, like, think.
I disagree. I think it stunk with her the entire way through.
Oh, but so I'll give her credit. Like, when she had her corny ass, no, I am in charge. It is not my granddad's paper. It's my, like, I thought that was a little good. Like, okay, yeah, she's got a backbone.
That was good writing.
Good moment. Good writing. But her character, so not even Meryl Streep as the actress, her character halted the movie, every scene she came onto.
I agree.
Are we supposed to feel bad for her? Because I don't. She's like, She's annoying. She doesn't know what she's doing.
Yeah.
I don't know enough about the actual story to know if that's faithful or not. Part of me wants to give them the benefit of the doubt that the actual real life person actually just sucked this much. But I'm not as hard on Streep as as you guys are.
You should be harder.
But this was the worst performance I've ever seen from her, I felt like.
And she got nominated Oscar for it because she's a trash
person. I don't know if it's the character or her, but just
it was a bad combination at the very least.
Were we supposed to feel bad for her character?
Evidently,
I didn't feel.
I don't know. Some rich white lady with a ton of money. I don't give a shit.
Who just had no direction or thoughts. It was like we're just gonna watch this lady add two and two for 40 minutes and not be able to come up with an answer.
And it felt like, because we were calling out earlier, it seemed like they wanted a very feminist movie at points, but her character was bossed around by all the men in her life throughout the entire movie, besides for maybe 1 5-minute scene, which isn't good. Like, that's not a strong feminist moment. If you want this to be a feminist movie, you did a shitty job of it.
I wouldn't say feminist. I would say woman empowerment.
Yes, woman empowerment.
Feminist has a negative connotation these days.
Well, real, like actual meaning of feminist doesn't.
Yes. No, but I know. I understand. I'm just fucking with you.
Yeah, the internet.
But
I don't agree with that.
what bothered me most is when that good scene with good writing, and she's like, this isn't my husband's or my father's company. The woman sitting next to me is like, yes, girl power. I'm like, oh, stop this, because this is one of my pet peeves, okay? Girl power is a thing of the past. It comes from being the losing standpoint, all right? Girl power is people rising up. The fact that today we know they're very equal, if not better in some situations, okay? They should have took this female character who is in charge of the Washington Post, a major publication, and made her, I don't want to say change history, but tweak it a little bit to make her not look like such a wimpy pushover, and have her coming to power a moment much stronger than when it was. Because it's not about people pushing her around. It's about them not respecting her. And they lost that. And her going out the fucking side door down the courtroom steps because she didn't want to be part of it, that was a sign of weakness. And then if you notice, everyone surrounding her was women because they weren't allowed near the front door. And they were silently saying, go girl power. They needed to have a stronger message than that. It showed how weak they were, and I didn't like that.
I agree. Jimmy?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I don't know. She didn't come off as someone I was rooting for. I didn't think her character was just terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
Next point.
No, Streep Hate's not done yet.
Okay.
One of my favorite shows ever is How I Met Your Mother. Jimmy, I think you hate the show.
I watched like the first 5 episodes. Wasn't for me.
That's fine. One of the episodes they brought up was the breaking of the glass, and that's when you notice something about someone that you know that irritates you to no end. And once you notice it, the glass breaks, and you can't not notice it. Meryl Streep overacts in every situation possible. She tries too hard, and she has to have props in her hands at every moment. Even when she's fucking sleeping, she has to be holding her glasses, or her glasses are stuck to her hand.
Okay,
I didn't notice that, but thanks. I'm gonna notice that now.
Yeah,
there was a lot of hands in this movie. Mm-hmm. Like there was a lot of scenes where they showed someone fidgeting their fingers like this. Almost every character was really hand fidgety.
And I guess that was for like show tension, but for Streep herself, she was always. I can just imagine herself, like, imagine her, like, waking up and talking to people like, no, I need to have my glasses in my hands because I'm working so diligently and I fell asleep on my work. I hate her.
That was an A-plus impression.
Yes. I think Meryl Streep hates the fact that her name is only 3 syllables. I think she wants to be Marilyn Streepford. I fucking hate her.
It's crazy that she got nominated for this.
Bananas.
It really wasn't.
I think this movie shouldn't have been nominated for anything. And I think the only reason it got any nominations was based on everybody's expectations.
This movie's one step above Battle of the Sexes.
Oh, yeah. You know what? I mean, I was going to say no, but yeah.
I don't know if I'd even give it a full. Like, it's a half step above it.
They're in the same league.
Yes.
They are definitely the same league.
Someone could convince me if they made a good enough argument that Battle of the Sexes was a better movie. I don't necessarily think it is.
Steve Carell.
But I could be swung that way.
Okay, do you want to hear my third complaint?
Of course.
I kind of understand this one, but Bob Odenkirk, Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul, Sarah Paulson, every FX show ever, Matthew Rhys, The Americans on FX, Alison Brie, Mad Men and Community, Jesse Plemons, Breaking Bad, Fargo, Carrie Coon, The Leftovers, Fargo, Zach Woods, Silicon Valley. This supporting cast was dynamite. If you've watched those,
Monster.
If you've watched the shows that those people are in, you would know how Carrie Coon is one of the best female actresses I've seen in the last 3 years. I don't know if you guys watched The Leftovers.
No,
it was she's remarkable. You wouldn't know any of them were good actors. The power or skill they have, their craft from this movie. It didn't. And I know that you can't have every person in a movie be this big character, but if you were someone watching this that didn't watch television at all, you'd be like, they were just some bit C actors, you know, that just got paid minimum to come in. That's a skilled cast, and that we didn't see any of their talent.
The thing that upset me the most was, because I'm a big Alison Brie fan, so when I first saw her, I didn't know she was in the movie at all, so I was thrown off. I was like, shit, she's in this, and I got really excited for her, being like, this is a huge break. She's in a Spielberg movie about a major historical moment. Like, this is going to do wonders for her, and she was in two scenes and maybe had 20 lines. And I walked out being like, I wish she had more. I know her character wasn't relevant at all, but I wish she had just been in another role then that made her character relevant, because she was the most underused, I felt.
Yeah. I mean, even Odenkirk, like, he's started off as a comedian, but in Better Call Saul, he has some scenes where he got really good acting chops. And it's just like,
I think he did an excellent job in this one.
He was good.
I wish I could have seen more of him, but I think he was the only like B level guy here that actually was worthwhile.
Yeah, they didn't even
they got the most out of him.
They didn't even let Carrie Coon give her line, which this is a serious question I have for you guys. Do you know what I'm talking about? She's like, we got the results, and it was, and then the other guy runs in from the back and goes, we won 6-3.
Yep.
Why did they do that? This was supposed to be a movie about empowering. Was that just supposed to remind us that women will never have power because men always step on their toes? That was so silly.
No, that's exactly what it was, and that's why I hated it. It it kind of went back on itself, back and forth, right?
Yeah, so this was supposed to be about women.
No, it was supposed to be about the freedom of the press, and they threw this woman thing in there. I guarantee this is a secondary one that they're like, while they're filming, like, yeah, let's do this too. But earlier in the movie, she was made a big deal of because she wasn't invited to the Nixon wedding, all right. And yeah, the only reason why a girl would be a focus in a press at that point would be to cover a wedding. That's it. And she was good at it. I guess she was very important in the room at the time. But that was subtly sexist that she was the only person. He at no point did he offer up like, well, we're gonna send another guy, because no, he's like, the girl's gonna cover that.
And I mean, but even take a step back from what the movie wanted, Spielberg took one of the biggest lines away from a female actress in his movie and gave it to some dude who just ran in and like blubbered it.
And the worst part,
I think
that part that aggravates me the most too is, you didn't even need her to start to say it. If you just had the guy run in, it would have been fine. Or if you just had her say it, it would have been fine. But having her start to say it and then get cut off is just an
insult to
women. How
did that come
to
be? Who wrote that in the script or directing room? Made no sense. Give Carrie Coon her line. Let her say it.
Yep.
You know,
there's no way that's historically accurate, because no one can know that in the press room.
No, there was some big there was a conversation about why that had to happen like that, and like a big reasoning, and it doesn't make sense to me. Spielberg's known for never having good women characters or powerful women characters. That's one of his things.
Yep. And I think this is he's definitely lost his fastball here.
Well, I mean, I didn't see the BFG, but Bridge of Spies was pretty vanilla, I thought, as well.
Very.
I didn't see that one.
Very.
And And I think this is kind of like old folks home vanilla as well. So,
yeah. Yep. He does well with period pieces.
Well, yeah, I'll touch on that when we hop into audience reactions. But what else do we got for hating it? Or liking, if there's anything else you guys liked.
I think hate's not my word. It's like kind of disappointed. It was just
complaints.
It wasn't bad. It just wasn't close to good. It was very middle of the road.
I'm glad you brought up all the top notch the actors, the supporting roles, because I was distracted watching them because there was some people had noticeably fake hair, and other people had noticeably bald heads that they like tried to. It looks like people with hair, they shaved their heads or made them thin. People without hair, they put fucking toupees on. And there was way too much fiddling with hair. Did you pick up on that too? The costume, makeup and costumes were a disaster.
I missed that.
No, but
I wasn't paying attention to that.
So did you guys notice, and this was different, I was in the front row of the theater because I got there late, which sucks. My theater, the front row's tough. Two front row. It shouldn't be offered. It's like really, really bad. But close-ups, this was filmed kind of weird. There's a lot of shots of following people because you can only make walking around with a envelope so dramatic.
It felt very West Wing-esque every time they shot it, but not in a good way. Like they were like, it was an amateur imitating West Wing.
It was a lot of weird ass shots, like unflattering following an ass shot through an office building. And then there was a lot of times where it was close-ups, like really close, where I'm just looking at this dude's teeth. Like, dude, I don't want to be this close to this guy's teeth.
When they zoomed in on Streep as she was thinking about if they were going to print it or not, it got way too aggressively close.
Oh, dude. Way too aggressively close. Her mouth is weird. I don't want to come off like I don't want to dive down that road.
She's ugly.
Make fun of someone's appearance. Her eyes and mouth weird me out.
She's ugly.
I agree. Six pack gives that an endorsement.
Jimmy did not say that. He doesn't want to endorse that. But John Sheehan here is saying that Meryl Streep's an ugly bitch.
She's not attractive.
I'm not going to go that far. She's unattractive.
Which bodes well for her acting chops at the beginning of her career, I guess.
Unless she was hot in the beginning of her career. I don't know.
No, she wasn't. She was a weird-looking alien lady.
She wasn't. Okay. She wasn't.
All right.
I saw her in Kramer vs. Kramer when I was like a junior in high school. And I've hated her guts ever since, just for the character she played in Kramer vs. Kramer. Fuck that character.
even I can say that's a bit unfair, but yeah, no, I'm.
I just seen Kramer vs. Kramer.
Oh, but yeah, but like, I'm not gonna let one role dictate someone's career. For
yeah,
me.
But have you seen Kramer vs. Kramer?
It's a summation. Yeah, I have. It's a summation of all of her.
Fuck her in Kramer vs. Kramer.
I know. Yeah, she's miserable.
I don't know. I hate her because she's a hypocrite.
She's an asshole. She's a mouthpiece.
That and the fact that she's one of Polanski's like biggest defenders, but she also calls out other people. Like, we don't have to get into that, but the guy's an admitted child rapist. And she defends him and is signed that letter saying he should be allowed back into the United States.
She knew.
All right. Well, that was enough Streep hate. anything else on your list, Jimmy? Or Sheehan?
No. No, I cleared my list.
Sheehan, anything else? Or do you guys want to do audience reactions?
How far are we? We got 30 minutes in. Let's go into audience reactions. I could keep beating this thing all day, but...
Yeah. Trying not to make this too much of a negative podcast here, guys. All right. Sheehan, what do you got for your audience?
I have several things. First of all, you can tell it's an old movie because... or old person movie. I went on, 7 o'clock on a Saturday, so not prime, early bird special time, but there was definitely a blue hair aspect to it. And I was reminded of that about every 5 to 10 minutes when the door would open, because these people can't stop taking a piss during movies. It was consistently people getting up and going out and peeing, and the door slammed every single time. That bothers me.
You sound like an old person.
I am. There was a gentleman behind me. He might have been cooking. I don't know what the hell he was doing, but he was making food back there. Upsetting. You noticed it was old people too, right?
I did because I went with three friends, and we were the youngest people there by at least 30 years. So, like, people in their 60s was the rest of the crowd. And it was also a very you could tell which way the crowd was leaning politically, because anytime freedom of the press was brought up, they would audibly cheer for minutes, over a minute.
This is why I wanted to bring it up, because I'm going to say maybe a guy, can't tell, down the other end of the theater from me. When Streep delivered that line and said that the Supreme Court came back and said that the press is for the governed, not the governors, guys went, oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, for a fucking minute.
My whole theater erupted into cheers, except for me and my three friends, and we were looking around like, why? These actors can't hear you. They don't know you're supporting the movie or in their cause right now. There's no point to cheer at a screen.
Yeah, these people just creamed everywhere. All of a sudden, it was like eruption. Like, they've never heard this line before.
That had to be in the actual ruling, right? The opinion?
Yes. Yeah. That's actually a famous line. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's...
Yeah. Real good line, though.
I mean...
Yeah.
It's a great line. But I would expect people who lived through it to fucking remember it. I don't know.
Speaking of lived through it, I walked out of the theater.
You lived through the movie?
And the lady that was in front of me, she's an older lady, with her... I'm guessing her daughter and son-in-law. And she said, it's so crazy to watch a movie that I lived through. Because she was old. And I was like, yeah, it's a really old movie, Spielberg. You make movies for old people now. But then she knew she was talking. She was like, and the one actor from Breaking Bad, and the other from The Americans, and the other from... And I was like, oh, this is a cool-ass grandma. She watches a lot of TV. So maybe Spielberg makes movies for cool people.
That's what it is, definitely. Oh, yeah.
I was in the front row, so I didn't know what was going on in my theater, and I realized that I have kind of like anxiety when I sit in the front row, and there's just all this behind me that I can't see.
Not fun.
Maybe James Holmes ruined that for me, but it was not fun. I don't like sitting in the front row.
So for this, I had to sit in the front row as well, because it was actually the weekend we saw Shape of Water. I saw this because I tried to go see Shape of Water, and we showed up 45 minutes early, and it was already fully booked except for... like four seats randomly without, and we didn't want to sit separate. So we went to see this same time, and it was the only seats were four in the very first row. And I just had this bad radio because you can't see me, but I was just looking up, slouched down the entire time, and it was not a fun viewing experience.
Do you and your friends talk to each other while you watch movies?
No.
I was going to say, what does that matter? Like, I've never understood, like, oh, I can't sit together. I'm not going to watch a movie.
I agree with that, but it's two couples, so I don't think I didn't care, but nobody else wanted to split up.
Don't even care.
Yeah, I guess your girlfriend doesn't want to sit not away from the boyfriend.
Yeah.
Girls, am I right?
Yeah, the worst, am I right?
All right, sorry, what were you saying?
That's why I go all these movies alone.
My audience laughed anytime Meryl Streep's character couldn't make a decision or was wishy-washy. And I was like, you guys are kind of being sexist. Like, you're just making...
There's a bunch of dicks in your
just theater. Making fun of her for being so weak-willed and minded.
Well,
cool.
I laugh at Annette people, too. Whatever.
Yeah. All right, what do we got next?
I believe all that's left is to review it, or rate it. Sorry, we did just review it. To rate it.
Yeah, we reviewed it. We've about a half hour reviewing. Yeah, it's fine.
So let's start with our critical scores. Sheehan, what do you got?
I'm going to go 75.
75?
Yeah, solid C. Average. Like I said, they did too much. I feel like there was a good movie in there somewhere if they just focused. If the editors and Spielberg just popped a bunch of Adderall and took time to focus on this, they could have cranked it out, but they didn't, and I feel like Streep ruined it. I feel like Streep got her dirty little grubby hands in there and manipulated him to say, okay, we need to make it in this direction as well, because freedom of press is important now. That would have played, that would have done very, very well with the Academy this year, and they should have focused on that alone.
All right.
Fair.
Sorry.
Jimmy?
I gave it a 71. I think it's cookie cutter. I think Spielberg has lost any edginess maybe he ever had. It is fill in the blanks, make an uplifting story of freedom of the press and women's rights, and just cover all your bases and don't do anything out of the lines, or use Credence for the helicopter shot, use close-ups for emotion, just cookie cutter, not interesting. 71.
All right. I don't want to scare you guys, but Jimmy, I also gave it a 71. Hey, hey. This is 2 weeks in a row we've been on the same page.
72.
You guys have just been seeing too much of each other.
72.3 is the result.
I don't know if Jimmy has like elevated my taste or I've brought his taste down, but we've been on the same wavelength way too much.
This was like Battle of the Sexes. It was just like, come on, yeah. This soul.
It was just very vanilla, very mediocre, and doesn't deserve to get any of the praise it's getting.
The fact
I don't think it's getting much praise. I don't think.
Well, the awards. Like I'll say it again. The fact Meryl Streep's nominated for award for this character she played and how she played it is
outrageous,
bizarre. Mm-hmm. It's really crazy.
I agree. All right. Disgusting. So popcorn. I'll go first. I'm giving it a 2.5. It's a 2.5 popcorn. So it was very. I liked it for. I would have given it a 3, but near the end, it just got so heavy-handed and just kept going on and on that the last 30 minutes, I kept checking my watch being like, is this almost over yet? Like, wrap it up. I want to get out of here. So I just didn't enjoy watching it.
Okay.
Jimmy?
Yeah, I had a 3. I teetered on going 2.5 or 3, but I didn't want to leave the theater. I don't know. I really wasn't into it, though, so maybe 2.5 works. So I'll let Sheehan's dictate where we land here. I'm 2.5 or 3. I could have got up and left at any moment and would have never had a nagging sense to find out how it ended.
Yeah.
Okay.
100%. Sheehan, deciding vote here.
Well, I was going to give it a 5.
What?
No, you weren't.
No.
Oh, my God. It wasn't. I thought you were serious for a second.
I did really like it because... I don't know if I liked the movie, but so I love the story. I love what they told. I love Tom Hanks and anything. He made me feel good.
Yes. I'd love to see a different movie about this. That's how I feel.
Yeah, I genuinely enjoyed my experience. I got like I said before, I got to crank it up a bit because they have John Sheen or they have Neil Sheen in there, not John, whatever. 3.5. I did like it.
So just go 3.
3. That's fine.
We're going to call it 3. I can live with that.
All right.
Well, I don't know the biggest problem. We kind of talked about this. The most interesting parts of this entire historical situation is, one, the Vietnam War and Bob McNamara and his decisions to lie and what was actually on the papers they found. That's the first most interesting part about the story. The second most interesting part is how the Supreme Court case went and the judge's rulings and why they favored this and like that part. And the third most interesting is how they found the documents and their decision to publish them. And this whole thing was on the third.
Yeah.
Yep.
It should have been either a blend of all of those or at least the like finding the documents and the judges.
You hit it right before. It should have been about the judging and the Supreme Court decision.
Yeah. Not about we.
That's the interesting
thing. It was literally the crux of the movie was on the decision to publish. It was like, you fucking idiots, publish it.
This movie was made about middlemen. That's about it.
Yeah.
Yes.
It was the middle of the good story.
I like that. All right, that seems like a good spot to wrap up our review.
Gotta do pairings.
Oh, pairings. Yes, you're right.
How dare you? How dare you?
I forgot. Sheehan, what are you drinking with this if you watch it again? God help you.
I gotta find a little girl to sell me some 50-cent lemonade.
Oh, nice. Spike it?
Yeah, get a little spike. How much money did she make? But what a dick move of her father letting her like fleece his employees for that long.
He loved it. That was great.
That was just another Spielberg-esque old man humor in the middle of like this corny movie.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't dislike it, but you gotta admit that is just an old man joke in the middle of this movie. Like that is just
and it kept going. She kept like walking between them with a sign, kept walking around. It kept going. Mm-hmm. Little joke, but it
worked for me.
Yeah,
but it's definitely
I feel like
old,
it would have been perfect.
Humor.
It would have been perfect to be like you know little girls up front selling lemonade. Fine, but then seeing her with stacks of cash like walking around, I laughed. Didn't need to be. It was felt a little weird.
Yeah.
That might be my favorite scene out of the movie, actually, now that I think about it.
Maybe.
I'm just going to hop in here because I had a twisted tea, because lemonade tea, they have a twisted lemonade.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking.
That works.
So.
Yep.
Same boat as you. Jimmy?
Vodka water. Vodka and water. Mostly water. Just boring. Boring watered down vodka.
You're going to drink it in front of a gate?
Yeah.
Wink, wink. Watergate.
Fuck. Very nice.
All right. Well, now that wraps up our review of the post. Everybody let us know what you thought of it. Let's hop into our weekly recommendations. What have you guys been watching?
Jimmy, what have you been watching?
I, since I've been home the last 2 days, just been crushing shows. There's a lot of new shows out that I've been watching that are good. FX has their Anthropology series. They do the series right now is The Assassination of Versace, Gianni Versace. Sometimes these FX shows are corny, but interesting. So far, 2 episodes in, good. On Paramount Network, which used to be Spike, they're doing Waco, the story of Waco.
Ooh.
And the polygamist camp there, run by Dave, I can't think of his name. But Taylor Kitsch, Tim Riggins is playing the main guy, and our dude Michael Shannon is playing the second lead. 1 episode in, I really like that. I really like that story, because if you've ever seen, there's a documentary on all of it called Oklahoma City, about the Oklahoma City bombings, and how the FBI and ATF just fucked up their handling of the far right in the 90s. Really, really bad. They fucked up, and it backfired. Those are 2 good new shows. Also on Stars, Counterpart with J.K. Simmons, or what's J.B. Simmons?
J.K.
J.K. Simmons. Those are 3 new shows. Only 1 episode of each, or 2 of Versace. All good. But if you liked this movie that we just did, and you're interested in McNamara, which I said is actually the interesting part, watch the documentary The Fog of War. It's Errol Morris documentary, and it's just...
The what of war?
The Fog of War.
Fog of War.
So it is Errol Morris, I think is the name. You know what I'm talking about? It's a famous documentary maker. Yeah, Errol Morris. It's just Robert McNamara sitting in front of a camera telling his life story and Vietnam and all that shit. And it's crazy. I mean, this dude was responsible for napalm. He was responsible for Vietnam and like tons of deaths. He was a whiz kid. He was really smart in his 20s. Henry Ford hired him when Ford was about to go bankrupt, and hired him and his buddies. And they did such a good job on Ford that Kennedy hired them to be on his team. It's a crazy story. So it's really historical. So a lot of people would say it's boring, but if you're interested in these papers and these tests and the Vietnam War, watch that documentary.
All right. I'll check it out.
Nice. Definitely will.
Shin, what have you?
I can't wait for the next round of these movies to come out in 30 years about now.
Yeah.
Oh, those are going to be great.
They're going to be really great. I lived through that.
Yeah. I'll be that Breaking old Bad person awesome. Cheering on in the theater. Shin, what are you watching?
I had about a quiet week of TV watching because I had a lot of shit to do at work, but I started up the 2nd season of The Crown. Just fantastic.
Yep.
Really, really powerful stuff. I'm only a couple episodes into it, so I won't dive in too deep. What I want to talk about, though, is I texted you guys the trailer to Chappacondrick, or Chappacondrick, what the fuck is that name?
How do you get
Chappacondrick? Yeah. Yeah, Chappaquiddick. There we go. You didn't watch the trailer yet, Jimmy?
I did. That title, though, was bizarre.
Oh, yeah, well, it's the island where it happened.
Yeah.
Massachusetts is full of weird fucking names.
Indians.
How's the trailer, though?
Native Americans. I am stunned that they made a movie out of this. It's absolutely, like, blown away. Like, my jaw hit the ground when I saw it come up. Because, I mean, it's always been a black spot on the Kennedys, but it's always been shoved under the rug. And, I mean, the guy just died 5 years ago now. So it was relatively fresh in that family. But for it to come out is just crazy. He literally just, like, let a girl die in the water. And it's crazy now because everyone knows about it and still hasn't done shit about it.
Yeah. I mean, what are you going to do now?
Yeah, I mean, there's not much you can do.
Nothing you can do. I mean, none of Ted Kennedy's kids are in Congress. He had one kid in Congress who fucked up really hard, and I think it was only one term, and he was too high half the time. So his nephew's in Congress now for New Hampshire. So the Kennedys are still in politics, but nothing. This won't hurt them at all, I don't think. It shouldn't. But it's just like a wake up as to like, hey, the Kennedys were like the golden family. They were like the royals of the America.
Yeah.
For so long. And now it's just like we all knew they're drunk assholes. They're sweet talking drunk assholes, but drunk not assholes nonetheless.
And I'm a fan of the Kennedys, just, so I'm also gonna call out they started the Special Olympics and donate a lot of money to that.
Oh, they've done some good things. Some good,
but, they're definitely assholes, like but they also support some good causes. Shout out Special Olympics. That's what rich people. The pod.
Don't fucking keep your money, please. You need it. We Jesus, you derailed me there. Yeah, no. They are. I'm stunned that they made this movie. I can't wait to see it. The guy who played, he was a star of Mudbound too. Guy who plays Ted Kennedy, dead ringer for Ted Kennedy at that
Hedlund?
Age. It's actually, yeah, dead ringer. It's actually creepy.
I gotta be honest. The weird though, jaw. That commercial shit? Looked. That trailer looked bad, in my opinion.
Really?
I think the story's interesting, but
I think Ed Helms might have fucked up his Boston accent.
Yeah, Ed Helms looked like a weird miscast to me.
I don't know. I think I'm hoping for the best because this story it deserves to be out there.
Yeah.
For the masses. Everyone, have you heard of this story before this?
Very.
I knew.
Yeah. It's one of those things that everyone's like, oh, yeah, he got concussed and a girl died in his car. Yeah.
Garrett Hedlund.
But yeah, it wasn't like, oh.
Garrett Hedlund doesn't play Ted Kennedy, the older racist brother.
Oh, okay.
For Mudbound.
All right.
Yeah.
I had said Garrett Hedlund brother. And you said yes, because I haven't seen the trailer yet.
Yeah.
Oh, because I don't know who Garrett Hedlund is. I don't know this guy's name. I go by his face.
Garrett Hedlund.
Garrett Hedlund is from Tron. He's the younger brother in Mudbound.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No, not that guy. Okay. The other one.
Oh, Jason Sorry. Clark?
Yeah, something like that.
Yes. He was in the second Planet of the Apes.
Sure. Yeah, the guy with the big chin.
Yep.
Crimson chin.
Yep. Yeah. Well, anyways, regardless of how that movie is, if it's good or not, the poster is going up behind me as soon as I get it. It's a fantastic poster.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see it. Bad radio, but it's the American flag upside down with a car floating in between it.
That is a really good poster.
Yeah, I like that poster.
It's a great poster. So go watch the trailer. That's my recommendation for the week.
I got two. The first is, I think I was the last person to watch it, but I watched all of The Handmaid's Tale this week. It's a damn good show. Go on Hulu, watch that. I got sucked in, pretty pumped for season two, come out in a couple of months. And then also last night, I watched episode one of the first season of True Detective. I forgot, The woman hasn't seen it yet. So we started that, and it's very, I forgot how good that show is. Just even from the first episode, I'm so excited to watch the rest of it again. It's on my Mount Rushmore of greatest TV shows ever that season.
Yeah, I think it belongs there.
I think it absolutely does.
Homeland,
but it
Homeland starts
part of that. Does it? Why?
Are you not up to date? It got really good again.
Really?
Yeah.
I skipped last season.
Yeah, last season. So this season is a continuation off last season. So finally there's some continuity and they're not one-offs. And last season, the first three episodes of last season kind of were slow. And then there's a snap point where it's like, ooh, okay, this is really interesting. And last season was good.
All right. Well, I'll give that one a shot again.
Season two was mediocre. Season three was god-awful. Season four was okay. Season 5 was good. I think we're on 6 now. Season 1 was one of the best first seasons of TV ever.
Really? I haven't seen it.
That's
Oh, it rivals True Detective season 1.
Really?
Absolutely does. No, it is truly good work.
I'm going to add that to my list. Speaking of True Detective though, what do you guys think about this potential or not potential this third season that's going to be coming out either this year or next year?
No, I don't trust it. After seeing the second season, I'll have to be wowed in the first episode of the next one.
After the
I'm
second,
not going to give a shit.
After the second season and hit the writer, I can't think of his name, Nick something's interviews and shit, I am almost like anti him and True Detective.
Really?
But I'll check it out.
It's got Mahershala Ali.
I'm going to give it a shot.
I can't pronounce his name. Mahershala Ali.
Mahershala? Yeah. Mahershala.
Jigana Ali.
Okay, cool.
Jesus Christ.
It's got him in it, which I really like him. And the fact that he's had a few years to write this season and not just having to turn it around right away makes me more optimistic.
Maybe.
I didn't hate the second season as much as a lot of people. I just feel like everybody hoped it would be as good as the first, and it wasn't even half as good as the first.
It wasn't even good.
It was really
convoluted.
Bad.
And self-serving and...
Very bad.
Yeah. I don't know.
I
can't even tell you the story, to be honest. And I watched every episode twice, trying to figure it out.
What's his name? Nick Pizzolatto or something like that.
Yeah. Huh. Pizzolatto, I think.
I think the best part of the first season was the fact that you could follow along on the internet and everyone was like throwing out these theories at you, like who's the Yellow King? It was exciting to be a part of.
Yeah.
And you can't catch that again by watching reruns, but so good luck to you again for the girl or whatever.
Yeah,
but,
she's not looking anything up and just watching it through. Like she doesn't know anything about the show. So
it's tough.
She's
going to
be
like that,
telling me her theories, and I'm excited just to hear what she's thinking.
See, sometimes some shows need to be sat on for a week in between episodes.
Yeah.
So you can think.
Westworld.
Think on everything Westworld, The Leftovers on HBO is the biggest example of that. If you binge watch The Leftovers, I think you'd be like, what the fuck did I just watch? What was that? You really need time to sit down and think it through.
Yeah. But we'll see. I don't know if we're going to binge it or just watch an episode every few days. Because, I mean, even last night we watched one, and then we were like, we need to switch to something else because this was so intense and she wanted to sit with it. Slash, it was also one in the morning and we wanted to go to sleep.
Yeah, that happens.
That too.
Yeah.
That's another one.
All right. Well, that wraps up this week's episode of Six Pack Cinema. Tune in next week. We are reviewing Lady Bird, another Oscar-nominated film.
My favorite movie of the year.
It's up there for me. I'd put it in top three.
We can
do
that.
I haven't seen it, but I cannot wait.
We want to do that before the Grammys, too. Next week, we'll do Lady Bird for a little bit, and then our top five personal lists.
That works.
For the Grammys?
I think he means Oscars.
Grammys are right now.
Jesus.
Oh, can we talk about fuck the Grammys? I was coming back from Brooklyn today, and it took me four times as long because they just shut down stops and trains. And we're like, get off here and walk like 20 blocks to the next train.
No.
That sucks to live in New York City.
Fuck the Grammys because it's the equivalent of giving The Rock best actor.
I mean, I'd be all for that.
I mean.
It is The Rock.
Who doesn't love him?
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks for listening. You all next
guys.
Week. Bye.
He's going